Welcome. Today I am joined by Rachel Holoko, and she is an Australian designer behind the website Pattern and Design. And she has been designing for almost 20 years, first in-house as a textile designer, and then as a freelance designer. And now she teaches and coaches artists around the world. So I'm really excited to connect with Rachel and chat because I think we have a lot in common. So I'm excited. Hi, Rachel.
Hi, hello.
Thanks for joining me.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Can you briefly tell us how you got into surface pattern design?
Yeah, so my journey's probably a little bit different to other people. I actually started off in musical theater as a sound technician.
Awesome.
And probably, like, I'm sure so many people can relate to, you know, I did all of the things as a kid, you know, made the cards, did all the creative stuff, and then just kind of fell into something completely different. And I think my yearning was always there to be, even though it wasn't like, it was still creative in some respects, the job I had, but it wasn't creative in the way that I wanted to be. So, and I know we've spoken about this before, but back then surface pattern design, like, you just didn't know about it. Like, it wasn't like,
what do we do without the internet? Like, I really don't understand.
It was completely different space. So I don't know. I just fell into it. I was doing this short course, fell into it, and I was like, oh my God, this is what I want to do. So I ended up studying a Bachelor of Textile Design, then went to work in industry, worked in industry for, you know, quite a long time. And then I fell into as well, like, got this opportunity to teach as well at a design college and also a university, and just then developed a love for teaching as well, teaching other people. And that's where my whole business kind of pattern and design started, because I was like, I want to share all of my skills with other people. And also what I noticed as well at university is that they teach you how to do surface pattern design, but you don't learn anything about getting started in a business. And as you know, like, once you start setting up the business side, there's this whole, especially now, it was very different when we studied as well, because back then the internet wasn't what it is
right
now.
Exactly.
Yeah, and there's all this stuff and stuff that you just learn, and I've learned it all by doing myself. Like, I've set up my whole business from scratch myself, you know, my website, everything. So just sharing all of that stuff as well. So being able to, you know, teach people and create course that really teaches people all of that stuff. So yeah, that's where I've ended up. So now I have a studio at home as well. I just sort of transitioned from obviously working full time to doing that, and also with having children as well, I wanted to be home more. So
the flexibility is definitely, you can't beat it. And it's interesting, like, well, you know, I'm on the same boat of wanting to teach to create a business. And I even, like, have said this before of, like, you know, as sort of when people talk about the pricing of courses being too expensive or whatever, I'm like, I paid $80,000 for my 4-year education. And
back then,
well, I don't, you know, that was an approximation. I got a lot of financial aid. Let's not say I didn't pay out of pocket fully, but no, you know, that was the cost of a university education. And I learned surface design, but I learned nothing about, you know, online, you know, having an online business, which, I mean, of course, but so the kind of knowledge that, like, online teachers can give now, it's like, it's worth the, like, such a fraction of the cost, you know? So.
Yeah. And you also learn as well over time. You need to, I mean, I know in my own business, in terms of learning different aspects, not to do with surface pattern design, I've had to invest to learn those things as well. So it's about investing in yourself when you feel like it's a good fit and all of that sort of thing, but it's investing in yourself to move forward as well.
Yeah, I agree. And I think we have a unique perspective also, because a lot of the stuff that you read about, like, building online businesses is sort of based on, like, being a business coach or being, I don't know, it's not artistic. And so I think that, you know, the way that I use certain programs are for, like, art projects too. You know what I mean? There's different ways to use things that people talk about Pinterest, but they're talking maybe more about blogging. And sometimes people are, might be pinning artwork, and, you know, so there's just so much difference between online businesses. So what kind of work did you do when you were working in-house? What kind of products did you design for?
Yeah, so I've done all sorts of different ones, but then, like, probably my last job and where I was at for a long time was, we did homeware, so bed linen mainly. And I was, like, the head designer there. But it was, the great thing about that role was that, and this was one thing that I was able to learn so much just in general about, just not just actually, and this is the thing that you, I guess you learn when you're in-house, is I guess it depends on the role, but in my role, because it was such a small company, I actually was involved with, you know, emailing China and all in that, you know, we used to go to China twice a year on, you know, to go and have a look at production and have a look, you know, talk to them about our designs and stuff like that. I used to go on buying trips overseas at least twice a year where we'd go, like we'd always go to like to the States from Australia or to the UK and things like that. And we'd go and have a look and see what's out there. And it just all that sort of thing that you don't get to see. So I got to see in-house that whole production from, and I got was involved in that in a lot of like the sampling and looking at the samples and being back and forth with the factories to make sure that they knew exactly what we wanted and on all of that side of it. So for me, that was huge in learning a lot about how the industry actually works.
Yeah.
Because it's so much more than just creating a pattern, hey, when you're creating a product.
100%. Yeah. And that was my experience as well. So I worked for a bedding company and then a company that did all kinds of home stuff. They did have a bedding division, but I was in the table linens division. And then finally, for Baby Gap, I did the apparel for Baby Gap. So, but the company in the middle was the one that was where I got all like so much hands-on experience because it was a smaller company. And I didn't actually like, I wasn't, involved in like, you know, emailing the manufacturers or anything like that in China. We had product people for that, but we were working hand in hand with them and they were bringing the samples and they were asking us questions about our designs to figure it out. So without having to email, I was getting that education about production and, you know, what is possible. And I wasn't going on the trips to abroad at the stage because I was more of a junior designer at that point. But you know, my boss would come back with all these samples and we'd look through and she'd, you know, we get to see the pictures and all that stuff. So having that sort of immersion is really,
it's really interesting as well. Like the process. So I still love, cause we did a lot of embroidery and printed bed linen as well. And it's just amazing just to see the process of how that all happens too. Like it's pretty amazing to see.
It's really interesting. And there's so many, so many different techniques. And that's something that, that is one thing that is difficult to learn if you're not like hands-on in an office or, you know, in a manufacturing plant or something like that. Do you have any other things? Cause I mean, I really credit so much of, you know, how I come into this business from, you know, working in-house and some of those lessons that I learned. Can you think of anything else?
Yeah. You know what? One of the things that first comes to mind is speed. You learn to be very fast. Mm-hmm. Don't you? You have to be very fast. So people, I don't know if people ask you this question. I often get asked by people, how long does it take to create a collection? And I'm like, well, I'm actually a pretty fast designer when I design digitally. Mm-hmm. Just because like I've been doing it forever, like you, you know, and you get really fast at it. You get, you know, you get your techniques, your processes and all of that sort of thing. But it really depends on so many factors. But if you're in industry, like when we used to have because the thing is that the production process is so long and the design process has to be done in a specific time for the next, you know, season or whatever. So you're designing really quickly. So you might have to do, you know, sometimes you might be doing 6 or 8 designs in a day and other times it might be 3 or 2 or if it's really complex or whatever it is. So it really, sometimes it is a lot of designs.
You can be moving really fast. I don't know if I ever did 6 or 8 in one day, but it depends on the design, of course. That sounds like a lot, but yes, it is. You move fast and that's what you get from constant repetition, right? When you are a designer and only a designer, you know, you here's the designs, do the designs, here's the brief, do the brief. And it's like, you know, in online business, even when I was doing mostly like all client work, I wasn't really teaching much. I was still sort of, there's still the marketing of getting client work, like pitching yourself to clients and, you know, working on your licensing portfolio versus your client work. And so you do get pulled out of constant just like designing, which I mean, is a breath of fresh air for me, but you know, that speed is a great skill. I agree.
Absolutely. And the other thing that I was going to mention is working to a set brief as well. Like you get used to doing that. So and it's not that you can just do whatever you want. You have to actually, and I think the other thing actually working in the company, like, so I know you've seen my masterclass and like, I do talk about having your own signature style. And when I talk about this, I think where I come from is more that I feel like a lot of people, when they get started, feel like they have to follow certain looks and trends in the way they work. And I see a lot of people that are, that create things in one way, and they don't, and I really encourage you not to do that, because we don't want to all look the same. But at the same time, when you work in industry, you have to adapt your style always to fit in with the company's brief too. And so that's a good skill to have too. It's actually good to have both of those things, where you can develop your own work in your own style, but then also if you're wanting to get freelance work or you're wanting to work in-house, that you can adapt that style to fit in with whatever that company is, so you can design to their brief, whatever it is that they want. Is it, you know,
that's definitely the perspective I have as well, as far as, you know, because people do, they're like, I need a signature style. And I'm the one to say, like, you're going to be okay if you don't have one yet. Like, I'm a freelancer. I still am, like, you know, not totally there on my signature style or anything. And it's because I started 10 years of designing for, you know, companies that had different brands within their companies and stuff like that. And so you're doing this like upscale thing, and then you're doing this really fun modern thing, and you're doing all the different styles, and you're working with artwork that's been purchased, that's totally different styles than what you could create. So, but you're like sort of mimicking that to like do coordinates or whatever else. So, I mean, having all that experience has sort of made it hard to narrow down my own personal style, but that doesn't stop me from working. So,
But I think that what I think about it a little bit differently, because I think sometimes people feel like I've had people come, oh, now I can only do flowers. Now I can only do these three colors. Now I kind of look at it like just designing from your heart. That's what I look at your signature style being. It's not that it has to be boxed into anything, because I would hate that. Like, I would hate it if I was like, okay, now you are this designer, or you're that designer. Who wants to be boxed in?
No one does. Yeah, that's why it's hard.
So bored. Like, we're evolving. We're artists. I think it's more that art, you know, and it depends on where you're selling your designs. If you're selling them on a print-on-demand site or that sort of thing, then absolutely you do want to have that. You want to stand out. You don't want to be like everyone else. If you're working freelance, it's different to if you're licensing, I think, as well. Mm-hmm. Because if you're licensing, obviously, you know, you've got to be different to other designers that are out there. Otherwise, you know, you're competing with the same look. And also agents won't want the same people on their books that are all competing with one another.
Agree.
So it's kind of all of that stuff. So I guess for me, when I talk about signature style, I talk about it in terms of actually the way that you're sort of thinking about it, in terms of, I'm going to say, like, not being, basically coming from the heart, not that it has to be this set thing. And I bet you though, if you looked at all your work, that you'd be able to tell it's your work. And that's the thing.
Most of it. But you know what? It's the stuff that I post on Instagram, I think has a look to it. But I do have some stuff in my portfolio that if you were looking through, that I don't really show out, but I do have, like, my agent has it on file. If you looked at it, you would be like, really? That's yours? Oh, okay. All right.
We develop over time as well.
Yeah. Just want to experiment, you know, try some different things. Once I got into Procreate, because I mean, I'm a vector girl. Like, I love Adobe Illustrator, but, you know, I've been trying to add more texture. I was trying to add more texture, and then Procreate, it's like, oh, it's just like so fun to draw on Procreate. And so now, I still do mostly vector, but then I have sometimes make collections fully in Procreate, and or 90% in Procreate. And I'm like, this doesn't look anything like, but it's okay.
I've done the opposite, I think, to, like, so many people that I teach. They're coming from art and then learning to create patterns, but I'm actually like wanting to, rather than do it, like, and then they're wanting to do it digitally. But me now, I like to do mine all by hand. I've gone back to, like, I love painting. So I love painting my motifs now. So watercolor has been my
new fave.
Your favorite thing to do.
That's good. I want to get it. I bought some gouache. Like, I when I studied in school, I did everything in gouache, you know, right?
Yeah, so did I.
So
computers were a bit scary back then.
Totally. And so I bought some gouache recently to, like, play around, but I'm just like, where am I going to put this? I have to set this up. I have to make I need to make it. I mean, I have plenty of room. You can see I have a big office, but it's just, I'm like, where is this all going to go? It's going to be a mess. Yeah. Like, oh gosh, I have to get over it and just
mess. That's kind of like watercolor, because then you've got the palette set up and you can just
do it. I can get even watercolor.
And I'm trying to, like, just for myself, like, regardless of it, at least do one thing every day. just like as in a practice, like just to do something, because I think you need to do that as well, yeah. And step away from whatever else it is that you're doing, whether that be, you know, a freelance job or other job, but yeah.
And get away from I agree. I don't do it. I try to do it and I don't do it as much. And I really have been feeling very stagnant creatively. And I've been giving myself grace of just like, you know, whatever it is, this is the time and I just don't have it right now and it'll come back. Yeah. But I know if I just did something messy and horrible each day that it would come back faster. I need to do it. You can call me. You call me and tell me to do it and I will. I need someone on my. The other thing I wanted to say about working in-house, that one lesson that has been so valuable for me and that I'm constantly reminding people that don't really realize it, is that artwork isn't personal. Like, or the reason you choose art is not personal in any way. You've seen it, you know, and it's like.
Yeah, absolutely. Yesterday, actually, I was interviewing an ex-student of mine that I taught at face-to-face quite a while ago. And we were talking about, I said, because she's been doing some fabric. She's selling fabric roll, like fabric by the meter. Like, she's doing so well. It's really great. Anyway, I said to her, don't you find, because she's like, you know, you got to pick the designs. I said, how are you picking your designs? Because what I find is the one I love, no one likes. And the one I don't like, everyone loves. So it's like, yeah, this, everyone's got different tastes. And she's like, oh my God, yeah, the one that was my favorite sold the least. It's just, totally. It's just the way it happens. And so you can't, it's, I know it can feel like, and people can get so attached to it. Yeah. And I think that actually, that's another thing that working in-house does for you.
Yes, agreed. Yeah, you don't get attached because it's just like through the door so quickly.
Through the door. Yeah.
And your supervisor, for me, my supervisor would be like, nope. And it's, and then yes. But you know, it's like, okay, all right, well, let's move on. Like, who cares? You know, if you say so, I'm getting paid either way. Right.
Exactly. And it's all about dollars and cents for them. They need to sell it. And if they know that the market is going to buy that and you know,
So yeah, it does. It gives some detachment. I agree. And I think that's sort of important. I mean, I don't know. I you know, there's pros and cons of both, but like, yeah, for being able to put yourself out there and have confidence in your work, I think that that is important, because if your whole self-worth is based on, you know, whether somebody likes your art, whether one art director likes your art or something like that, then that's obviously you're going to have a hard time in this business. So.
You know what? It might not even be that they don't like your art. It just might not fit their brand.
Exactly.
Yeah. So it's not even that. So, you know, you can get in your head so easily with these things.
I always tell the story of like how many times I've seen, you know, because we used to do planograms, which are the, you know, the layouts of like shelving and in the store. And, you know, it would be like, we'd pitch four or five designs and basically, you know, it would get rejected because they were mostly green and they needed a blue one. And like, and the color didn't work. Our design was all about like, you know, floor, whatever, something that couldn't be changed to blue. And so it's like, it's just silly stuff like that, you know? So.
You're just reminding me of something. When I was working for this bed linen company, we used to go up to a different state from where I live, and we used to have to pitch our work to this other company. And the guy, he was really fussy, but he was actually colorblind. he couldn't see. You'd be like, I don't know if you can actually see those colors.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. There we go. Yeah. that is so funny. So just to wrap up that part, is I would say that, you know, I appreciate so much having learned that stuff in-house. Obviously, many people that we are working with and teaching don't have that opportunity. They're not in a place where they're nearby, or they don't, you know, whatever it is that they're starting from scratch. But, you know, that is why we talk about this stuff, so that we can tell you guys, like, from our experience, you know, trust us, it's not that personal, you know, there, and practice with speed and stuff like that. So it's not that you need to be working in-house. It's just, there are a lot of great, you know, great lessons to come from it.
But also, I think we didn't have the opportunity. The opportunities weren't there back then that they are now in the same way. So it was kind of like you had to sort of do that.
Yeah.
No, you didn't have to. Like, there were freelance opportunities. It's not that there weren't, but like, it was like now there's much more opportunities just to get started without having to, you know, in the same way that, you know,
Yeah, because you could do, there's just so many ways to start.
Yeah, there's so many ways to start, you know.
So currently, do you mainly do freelance for the art side of your business? Do you mainly do freelance for clients, or do you license your artwork?
I kind of do a bit of both. Okay. Yeah, a bit of both. So it's kind of, I don't have like a licensing agent. I was working with an agent for a while, but yeah, I haven't been lately. And so it's just a bit of both. Yeah, I do. Awesome. Sometimes people want to do a commission piece. They're always fun to do when you can just, you know, they're like, they like the kind of style you do, and they commission you to create whatever it is. I've done a few things like that over the course of last year, which was really great. And yeah, so just, yeah, a bit of both, I would say.
Cool. How did you find the transition from working full-time to running your own business?
So I did that when I started doing that, I had just had a baby. So it was, I kind of went from full-time to maternity, working part-time with the baby. Yeah. So it was kind of one of those journeys I was really lucky at that time. I had one client that I used to get a lot of work from. So that was kind of my work that I used to get that was consistent. And then, and this is why my biggest advice is, you know, don't put all your eggs in one basket. Mm-hmm. Really have a multifaceted business plan, idea of the way you're going to run your business. Because if you just relied on one thing, and then like I did, the business closed, I lost my work. I had no work. So then I had to kind of, you know, find other work from after that. I mean, it was really good at the time, but that's what happened. So I think I really highly recommend for people to think about more of a multifaceted approach, you know, maybe licensing and freelancing, and maybe you've got, you know, whatever it might be, whether you've got some designs, you know, on print on demand sites or whatever, you know, however you see that working for your own self and your own business, but not just having one thing that you're doing or one client that you're working
with. One client. Yeah, that definitely. No. And you know, it's true. I had not the same, but I was building up with client work, and I was trying to do licensing too, but you know, that was building slower. And so I was building up with client work, and one of my main clients changed to all in-house. So I went from, lost, you know, a sizable chunk of my income. So I was like building, and then my income went whoop. I was like, oh, this is sad. So
yeah, I had that happen as well, actually. Cause I started freelancing just before I went on to like maternity leave, and I went on maternity leave. And then, that same thing happened. I was like, damn it. Cause it was such a good client. I used to love doing the work for them as well. Yeah, this happens. They hire someone in house, and
it happens. And you know, just have to move on. So you know, as already we've been talking about, like it sounds like have a very similar career trajectory. And you know, now I think, you know, you're a few years ahead of me, because what you have done since, you know, in the last like 3 or 4 years is built a website called Pattern and Design, which is all about sort of teaching, as we've been talking about. And so I want to know, from someone who's been doing it longer, how do you split your focus between creating art and creating content and courses and all the things that go into that side of the business?
Yeah, and this is a great question. And I think that you're very much, similarly to you, two young kids, and that adds a whole other element to the whole mix as well.
Yeah, so add a third thing in there, the running a business, having them run around, so.
Yeah, so I think for me, there was definitely a period in time where I was doing less designing, where I was building my course, because as you've seen in my course, there's a lot of stuff in there.
We'll talk about that later. Rachel's current, her signature course, Patterns to Product, we will definitely get to that, but it is epic.
Yeah, so. It's a lot of stuff. So it actually, I think for me, because I was limited in time that I could record and things like that, the videos where there was not people running around the house and stuff like that, there was definitely a time during that period where I wasn't designing as much. But now I'm actually designing a lot more. So that's it's awesome. Kind of like the balance has kind of flipped, as there was just that period of time. I think definitely it's not my business not model right now isn't that I say, for example, if you look at a 9-to-5 week, it wouldn't be that I was designing 9-to-5 for 5 days. Like definitely, but I don't think anyone that is Anyone that has a business,
even if all you do is design, you're not designing that much, because if you own your own business, you have to be emailing, you have to be doing all this other stuff. So yeah,
exactly. So it's there's all of that stuff in there as well. But it's actually, it was interesting because I was talking about this recently with someone, and about setting up your day to make the best of your personal day as well. So for me, I always get like those kind of tasks done in the morning, and then I paint or design in the afternoon, because I find that for me, I don't have to think, it just comes, it's just relaxing, my music on. Whereas the stuff that I need to really use my brain to think about, whether it's whatever that might be, I try and do that in the morning and get that stuff done first thing in the morning.
Yeah.
So I think, so the transition has been, I guess it's just been, there has been definitely many, there was a period in time, and this was as well, I mean, and it's really going to vary according to each person's personal, you know, situation. But for me, having two little kids really quite young at the time as well, when I was setting all of this up, I was working late at night. I used to work late at night every night. And that was where I'd get a lot of the, you know what it's like when you're first learning to build a website, all of that stuff. Like I didn't know. And I did everything from the ground up myself, which I'm actually so thankful for now, because I have learned so much, like, because I have done it myself.
Yeah.
And then you can outsource, but if something goes wrong, you know how to fix it yourself. It's not like you're going, oh my gosh, that person is sick, I don't know how to do it, or I don't know how to fix my website, I don't know how to add a page to it or whatever. So I've done all of that stuff myself. In fact, one of the things, and I know that, like, I've worked with a lot of mentors and coaches and things like that myself, and what everyone says is, before you think, and I said this to my student the other day, because she was talking about growing her business and, you know, she's selling this fabric and selling, doing this and that. And I said, they always say you should hire someone before you think you're ready to hire them.
Yes.
To help you out.
Yeah.
So even if you don't think you need it, it's like investing in yourself before you think you need it.
Mm-hmm. I've been telling, I have also heard that. Yes. And I have been subscribing to that, in that I did think I needed it, because it was, you know, COVID, and I couldn't do anything because the kids were home and everything was madness last year. So I knew I needed it, but even people, who I was talking to someone, just today actually. And she was like, I've been thinking about, I was like, get it, you need it. So, you know, it's true. It's like, and even if it's 5 hours a week, you know, or something, you start small, you don't have to, you know, have a full-time employee or anything. So
whether that's helping someone, you know, someone's helping you with your social media or whatever it might be. You're definitely that.
Yeah.
You know, whatever it is, whatever task it is that could, you know, that could help you out, is really great.
Yeah. Yeah, it's true. Well, as far as, splitting focus right now, like I said, my art is kind of suffering, because, and you make a lot of content too. It's not just your course. I mean, your course is really dense, but you have a podcast. Like, I know you have tons of like blog posts and everything like that. And that's what has been, you know, my course is made. I'm like, you know, obviously tweaking it, but like it's mostly made. It's the blogging and the YouTube and the interviewing, which this part I love, you know, but I'm saying like, it does, it takes time away from, you know, drawing or whatever. So,
you know what my biggest advice with that is just to batch. So that's what I try and do. And I know we're going to talk about Pinterest a little bit later on, but even with, you know, that sort of thing, it's just all batching. I just do everything, like with all of the Pinterest Pinterest pins that I've created, I just batch them and then schedule them. So if you can get a scheduling tool that you're able to do all of that stuff, and same with the podcast. Like, I used to do IGTVs and then I just started to transition into podcasts, because I thought, oh, you know, most people prefer probably listen to a podcast than so that's why I kind of transitioned over. When I started doing IGTVs, it was kind of when it very first came out, actually, the IGTVs were big. But so anyway, I try and just batch them all, you know, and do it in one sort of, you know, period of time. And I find that that helps speed things up. And then you can sort of think, all right, I don't need to worry about that for whether it's a month or so. That's a really good way of people thinking about when they're, if, you know, I know listeners probably, you know, Instagram and stuff like that can feel so overwhelming when you're like, oh, I'm going to post on there. What do I do? So if you can sort of think about that and maybe schedule it out, even if it's for the week or, you know,
it just takes the pressure off that time.
100%. Yeah, it just takes the pressure off, because it's a lot, isn't it? There are a lot of tasks that are involved in running a business. And I actually, like, one of the things that I always say to people is, like, I think they forget that surface pattern design, and we all want to do the design stuff. That's the fun stuff. But if you want to run a business, then
have a business is profitable, guys. Remember, a business is profitable.
Yeah. A business, you have to think of it as a business, so that you, whether you're a, you know, an architect, or whether you're a hairdresser, whatever you are, if you're running your own business, there's certain tasks that have to come into that on top of just the actual doing tasks. And so carving out time in your week for that, for me, is something that I always say to people. Otherwise, you're not going to be successful if you don't do that, if you don't carve out the time, because you've got to spend that, whether that's, you know, spending half an hour a week, whatever, just researching some new clients that you can contact, yeah, or emailing those clients, or following up with those clients, or whatever it is. But having those business tasks, you know, putting yourself out there on Instagram or on Pinterest, yeah, or whatever you're going to be using, but just to add that into your schedule, like, that's just what you do each and every week.
Totally agree. I'm like, just put it in your calendar right now while I'm talking to you, put it in your calendar right now and just do it. And then, you know, and when you send out that pitch email, immediately, yeah, second step is put it in your calendar to follow up in a month or whenever your time frame is, like, no question. Then you get to that date and you're like, okay.
Yeah. And then just do it. Don't get, like, because
I know. Yeah. Yeah. That's all. I want to do a thing on procrastination because, I mean, I could just talk about it for so long. And I do it. I am not a procrastinator. I never have been. However, I find what I procrastinate on, it's certain things. You know, there are certain things that I procrastinate on, and it's because it's like, I don't want to do it, but there are reasons behind why I don't want to do it. I'm not sure about it. I'm not confident about it. I don't know if I'm doing it right, you know, so I get stuck and then I don't do it. And that's, you know, that can be a whole thing. So, yeah. I'm just, you know, brainstorming webinars while I'm on. No, but I was thinking about that today, about why we procrastinate.
A lot of that stuff is all to do with mindset and fear. It can, yes, be to do with fear. It can, yes, be to do with perfectionism.
100%.
Perfectionism is like a huge one. And I see it all the time. I was talking to a student. I do monthly calls in my group, and we do this live Q&A. And she does beautiful work. Like, she's, you know, it's just absolutely gorgeous work. And she's like, oh my gosh, you know, I'm stuck. And I'm like, you know, you've got to, like, I don't say this in terms of, like, if you were pitching your work to someone, I wouldn't say this, but for other things, like getting your website off, done is better than perfect. Just get it done.
I even say it for pitching, you know, that's one of my phrases, but I'll say it for everything, because otherwise you literally will never
get it done. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you don't want to put work out there that's terrible.
Well, yeah. I mean,
but at the same time, yeah, you don't want to be sitting there thinking that's going to be perfect, because, to be honest, you're your own worst critic, and it's never going to be good enough.
100%, 100%. And it couldn't be perfect. I mean, what's perfect? You know, again, it's all subjective. Like,
and I was to say another great saying from a mentor of mine. He says, 100% perfection is failure. No, 70% is perfection. 100% perfection is failure. He's saying it. Yeah.
I'm so, like, it's trying to wrap my head around that. Wait, 70%. Say it again.
70% is perfection, and 100% perfection is failure, he says. Oh, so it's okay. Like, if you're trying to
get on my calculator on that one, but yeah. Just kidding. You know, no, that's, like, a good one. I like that.
Yeah, you want to get it done. Just get it done and get it, like, especially, I think, and one of the things is with people's websites is that, and I say this with love and not to be harsh, but no one is looking at your website when you first put it up there.
No one is. You don't need it. You only need it to send a link to someone if you're pitching. No one's like, you're not getting organic traffic. Don't worry.
No, you build that over time. And then as you build that, you'll fix it. I mean, if I am ashamed to would be ashamed now to show my very first version of my website. It was horrible. Totally. It was so bad. And I've had, like, maybe 9 versions. So, you know, things like that, like, just getting started. Yes. Done is better than perfect.
Yes. Do it. I need to get an embroidery of that. You know what? Someone in my classes is great at embroidery. I'm going to commission her. Yes. All right. Well, now let's dig into Pinterest, because the way I first found you is that you pattern and design.
Like, oh, God.
Every surface pattern, everything, any surface pattern. Anytime I pin something, anytime anything, it's pattern and design. So you are all over Pinterest, which I love. And so share your secrets. How, well, I mean, even if you, you know, what do you have to say about Pinterest? Because I want to do it more. I now just got rebranded. So all my pins are beautiful, but they are not actually pinned yet. And
can I just say one of the bad things about Pinterest is that I've rebranded them so many times, but the old pins,
they stay, they all stay. Yes, yes. So my old ones, yeah. But that's also the good thing for, because now for us, we're talking about blog posts and like podcast episodes and YouTube videos or whatever, but most of the audience would be using Pinterest to show their art, to pin their artwork. And so you're not really rebranding that except for your logo in the corner or whatever. That is fine. And that's the great thing about Pinterest, is that whole like visual search engine that's kind of evergreen, you know?
Absolutely. And it is, it's a slow burn Pinterest, I will say. Like if you, for example, were looking at social, like Instagram or Facebook, which is instant in someone's feed, they click on that link or whatever that you want them to do. Whereas Pinterest is a slow burn. It can take some time for people to, you know, see the pins, and then, you know, someone pins it. Like I've even run ads on there before, and I still get people clicking through those ads, and I'm not paying any money on them anymore. Like I turned them off ages ago. So it just kind of, the organic nature of it is really amazing. I started with Pinterest, was the very first thing I did. It was that very first course I ever bought, was a Pinterest course in terms of my business. That was the first investment like that I made.
Yeah.
And the reason I did that was actually something that actually everyone probably, some of people will relate to, was, and I was very scared to put my face and my name to my business for a very long time. Mm-hmm. And I hid behind my business name and for me. Yeah, that's why. And I didn't even have, until I remember one lady said to me one day, she's like, you know, everything's lovely, but you've got, like, I had a stock image of a photo of someone on there, even, it wasn't even me. Like, oh, I was, like, it was kind of like, you didn't show a face, but it was kind of like, just, you know, like maybe, it'd be really lovely just to see your face on there. And I was like, yeah, I should just do this. And so slowly over time, and now, like, you know, I'm fine, it takes time. So that's why I did Pinterest, because I felt like it was less exposing for me or something like that. And that's why I started with Pinterest. And I found that was very easy, because it was just easy for me to create. We're all creative, so it's easy to create like an A4, like, well, it's not A4, but, you know, like a pin, you know. And so I did that. And yeah, and it's all about keyword and searching and things like that. So people, that's why when you search for something, often there's Pinterest pins that come up that you know, like when you search for anything on the net. And so it's a really great way of people being able to find your work and see it. And so often art directors, I think, find people's work through Pinterest.
Oh, 100%.
And, you know, all of that sort of thing. So I began using it primarily for blog posts. But I found, like, I've actually on Pinterest even found things of mine. I'm like, oh, I didn't pin that. But people pin things even from my Instagram.
From website, I don't know if you noticed that.
Yeah, or from my website onto Pinterest as well. And designs, I've got to say, if I look at the pins that I've got posted, the design pins are the ones that get repinned the most, which is really interesting. But the great, you can also then, what you want to do in Pinterest as well is, obviously, you'd know this, of course, but to have a business account where you can have rich pins, so they get linked straight to your website. So I think you might even be able to put in a URL to a print on demand site if you had a shop or an Etsy shop, I think. I don't know. I've never done it myself. I'm pretty sure you can.
Yeah, you don't see why not. If you're creating the pin, you can put it linked to anything pretty much.
Yeah, linked to. Yeah. And so that way, if you had, say, for example, you were selling some cards, or you were selling, you know, whatever it might be with your designs on it, you could link it to that. And so you could use it. It's a really good tool that is free to get traffic to your website. So that's kind of why I did it. It was a free way of getting, you know, a free way of me getting people to come over and see what I was doing, rather than having to use paid traffic. So that's the bonus of Pinterest. And there are lots of like little intricacies with using it as well. And like, I mean, I'm no expert. I can only, you know, speak of the way that I've kind of been taught to do it. But I also know that it, you know, what social media is like, changes every 5 minutes in terms of best practices. But, you know, there's a whole lot of best practices and things like that. But one of the great things is that you can have multiple pins to the same thing. so the same post or the same product or whatever it might be, and then just post those over time. And then so that's a good way as well. But it's all about being consistent on there too. So like anything else, you get rewarded for your consistency in posting. And so I schedule out all of my posts, and I use Tailwind, which is an amazing tool. And they are partnered, I think, even with Pinterest. So they've got best practices in mind as well. And so, yeah, that's kind of what I've done. I've just made sure that I really batched it. I keep it consistent. I'm probably less good on there these days than what I used to be in the beginning. Mm-hmm. In the beginning, that was kind of my sole source of, you know, traffic and things like that. Whereas now there's so many other things going on that sometimes I'm like, oh, geez, I've got to, I better pin some pins because I batch it. But yeah, like you said, it just keeps on rolling over and rolling over in the background because, yeah, people are always pinning on different things.
Yeah, I think, and you know, I like that it is, you're right, it's a slow burn, but it's also lasts so much longer, right? So you think of Instagram, no one's going back and seeing your old Instagram posts. Like if someone new discovers you, they might scroll down your profile, but like it's not getting reserved to people. But which is why I totally use the same image over, like, you know, 8 months later, I'll post again, because who even remembers or cares?
But they also, the whole of your audience may not have seen it anyway.
Exactly. Yeah. So I reuse for sure. But
way to go, repurpose.
Yes, exactly. Yes. But for Pinterest, you know, yes, you might not get immediate, like, you know, likes or repins or whatever, you know, the kind of immediate gratification that you might get from Instagram. But yeah, then it's just on there for a long time, and people can be discovering it. And you know, artists invest so much time in Instagram versus, I feel like, you know, some people, I mean, I hear of some artists who really use Pinterest, but I personally don't use it that much, or I haven't, for my artwork. But I know, I mean, people do get jobs from Pinterest. Like, I mean, I think of, like, just anecdotally who I have heard who has gotten work because someone saw their work on Pinterest versus Instagram. And you know, they both are totally valid, and I know people who have gotten work from both platforms. So
I have a lot of people contact me through Instagram, but a lot of the people I find that a percentage of those people are people that, you know, there's a lot of people that contact you, but they're not really that, you know, they're not really wanting to pay for service that designer, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So there've been some really great clients that I've gotten through there, and then there's been, you know, and I think that's to be expected, that people should expect that as well, is that when you do get contacted through Instagram, that, you know, you want to still stand up for, you know, your
integrity value as an artist. So Pinterest, guys, get on it. If you're not using Pinterest, I mean, I know it's just another thing to add to people's to-do list. So it's like, oh God, now I got to figure out Pinterest or whatever.
With Tailwind, like even with Instagram, like, you know how you can pin, like you can pin onto Facebook the same images and do it at one time. So through Tailwind, you can actually post to Facebook, and I think even maybe to Instagram at the same time, or they've got a separate Instagram one. And I think you can even like link it, so when you post one thing, you can post it across everything. And I think, and the other thing that I've heard as well is that Pinterest are getting used to, you know, when it used to be just the vertical images, but now they're getting used to seeing like Instagram images on there as well. And that's okay. So I think that's another way of looking at it. If you can pin one thing, and it's all about ease and fast and making it simple for yourself. You don't have to make it hard. So if you can do something like that, I mean, Tailwind is a paid tool though. I know some people that might not suit some people, but you can actually pin across platforms.
Yeah. Good one. Now I want to dig into your masterclass, your class. So I recently watched, I was mentioning, Learn How to Create Successful Pattern Designs from you, your masterclass. And I will, of course, put the links to all this stuff in the description. And so, you know, I just want to say, so I know that your signature course, Pattern to Product, is like a really deep dive into how to create service patterns from like 0 to 60 with, you know, like how to do Photoshop, how to do Illustrator, the types of patterns, all the different like aspects that you need. And I really loved the masterclass because it was more of sort of like a high level version of like concepts that you need to be a service pattern designer, where the signature course, which I got a preview of, is like, you know, the real nitty gritty of everything. And so I wanted to ask, what is the most common thing that you see missing from new designers as they get into their service pattern journey?
Do you know what, one of the things that just going into the course, and one of the things that I really, really love in teaching is that, I also give feedback to my students we have a Facebook group and I give them personalized feedback. So I'll do like a little video of my screen and I'll show them exactly where to fix the design or what they can do to improve it. And I think that's actually something that a lot of people like, could be very valuable for people. And if you get the opportunity to be able to work with an experienced designer in that way, I couldn't recommend that enough, because I see how that my students' skills really improve over time when they actually, you know, they
having someone sort of help you. That is, yes,
so invaluable. And I know that like there are, I know that a lot of people are in like little peer groups and things like that. And that's great. I think it's really, really great. And it's really great for keeping them, well, actually it's sometimes good and bad. I think if you're in a peer group and you're all working together and someone's doing really well and you're not, it sometimes makes that person that's not doing as well stop. But sometimes it can give them the momentum to keep going too. So it kind of be twofold. And it's great to, you know, get that encouragement and that, you know, connection with others, but you're not going to get that objective feedback from someone who's actually worked doing this, you know, in industry, et cetera. So if you can get that sort of feedback in any way, then I would highly recommend doing that, because that's what's really going to help you propel forward. Develop your critical design eye is so important as well. And I think that that will help that. And so what I always say to my students is when they're learning, so it's the process is the process, and you're going to do it all over again, over again, over again, every time you create a design. So I always say when you're getting started, don't even worry what it looks like. Who cares what it looks like? You're learning the process from start to finish. The more you do that process, the better you're going to get. So I kind of like, rather than having this idea, if you've never done it before, you're not going to be able to execute that idea necessarily.
Yeah, that can get frustrating.
It's frustrating. So just do it and like, oh, this is how I develop my ideas. This is how I create a repeat. This is how I create collections. Great. Now I can go back and I can do it again and I can do it again and I can do it again. And the more and more and more you do, the better you're going to get. So I think not getting stuck in worrying about perfectionism is what, like we were talking about before, perfectionism, mindset, fear. You know, people get, I see it all the time, getting stuck in fear of being that either their designs have to be perfect, there's fear of showing people their designs, fear of contacting clients and things like that. So I think that just not getting stuck in fear and just putting yourself out there is really important, and getting comfortable with being uncomfortable is another one.
It's true. You know, that feeling,
yeah, as you're growing, if you want to grow as a designer, then you're going to have to go through that. If you want to stay stuck where you are, then you obviously can to do that. But if you want to really grow, you need to get comfortable with really getting uncomfortable with things like, yeah, showing people your work. And I think the mindset thing is massive. Just trying to not stay in fear. And the other thing is the other thing that's really important to remember is that people are judging you all the time, like all the time. So no matter what you do, someone's going to judge you. So who cares? Just let them judge you. Like they're going to judge you anyway. So you might as well put the work out there.
It's true. God, it's like, I don't know what to do with my hair. So the worst I could do is have it's like, there's always something, right?
There's always something. And I just think, you know, that is, yeah, I think for me, probably the most important thing is that I could recommend is just, yeah, learning the process, not getting stuck in perfectionism, and just move, because that's going to help you move forward. Yeah, because I often see, like, especially when I've got, I love it because I get like a really broad range of people that join my program, and some of them are brand new to the programs. That's the other thing, actually, I will just say, is that, I mean, I don't know if you can remember that feeling. I actually can remember it way back when I very first started learning Photoshop and Illustrator. I can remember my teacher, and I remember the room and everything, and her teaching us the tools and us going, oh my God, she's just moving. Oh my God, like, it's so fast. How are we going to learn this? But there's no quicker way to learn it. There's just the tools, and you just have to go through that process, and it is overwhelming, and it's overwhelming for everyone. And we all started there.
It's okay to be a beginner, you know. We compare ourselves to what's happening on Instagram or whatever and feel like we're never going to get there, but
you will if you practice.
Yeah,
you will if you practice. And it's about putting in the effort as well. Like, nothing will happen without, you know. Actually, my sister works for a company that is that's done very, very well. And she was saying, like, you know, we were talking about how her boss always says, yeah, the reason that not everyone is successful is because, you know, it's not easy necessarily. You're going to have setbacks and things like that. And the ones that are successful, and that's why sometimes you can see designers out there that might be the same level, and one's doing really, really, really well, and one's not doing really well. Like, it's often the fact that, you know, they're putting themselves out there, their mindset, they've got the right mindset, they're stepping into, and this is something that I do talk a lot about in my course. We have a whole module on it, stepping into the mindset of a successful designer. And it's about being, and, you know, rather than, you know, just doing, you have to actually be that designer to actually achieve that, if that makes sense. So
yes, it's all about a mindset. Be your next level, whatever your next level is. I mean, I've heard that definitely too from coaching and stuff like that, is like, you know, whatever you want to be that already. Like, what's the difference?
Be that already.
Yeah. So, and that is, you know, that's advice that I give as well. Well, I mean, certainly mindset is so, so important. And the simplest advice I have a masterclass as well. And the, like, one hot tip is basically, like, tell people you're a designer, like, tell people you're designing, because people will be designing and not tell even, like, their, you know, sister or whatever, because they're doing it in secret, because they're nervous, because they're whatever. You can't get a job if you won't tell anyone. You're only, like, talking to strangers on, like, Instagram who also design. Like, you have to tell people around you that you design, you know.
And, you know, there's that thing of where if you tell someone something's bad, they'll think it's bad. If you tell someone something's good, they think it's good. You know what I mean? That thing. So if you've got to back yourself, so if you're there going, this is my design, it's kind of okay, then they're going to come at it with that, oh. But if you say, yeah, I did this, it's amazing, I'm so happy with it, they're going to look at it in a different way too. So it's like being confident about what you're doing when you're showing
them. I think that is so true. That is really true. I think I might have built my career on that. This is great, don't you think?
I love it.
Such good advice. Well, your masterclass, like I said, I will link to, and that is, you kind of go over the, like, pillars of a successful designer.
It is more high level, like, because it's an hour long, we obviously can't go through step by step, this is how you do it. It's high level. It explains what you need to know, and then obviously the processes, you know, if anyone's interested in learning those, that's what we do in the program itself, because it takes time and everyone's at a different stage, and there's no way that you can be doing something like showing someone how to create a pattern design from start to finish, or a collection start to finish in an hour.
I'm an affiliate for Rachel's course, and that's what one thing that I really like about it is, because I don't want to teach people how to do pattern design. I tell people, like, when you've got some patterns that are good, like, I'll tell you how to do the other business stuff. But Rachel is telling you, like, literally how to, you know, do the first step in how to open a Photoshop document, practically, you know, and Illustrator too, both sides of it. So, like, all those like nitty gritty details are like, you know, I mean, that's invaluable. So.
And I know we've spoken about this before, but, like, you can do it in Photoshop as well as Illustrator. You can do both. That's why I like to teach both as well.
I'm spreading. I am personally am a Illustrator, you know, fangirl, but I do try to spread the word and let people know that it is okay. Some of my other interviews, recently interviewed Nicole Tamarin, and she is a very talented very detailed watercolor artist and licensing artist. And so, yeah, she never, of course, is watercolor. She never uses Illustrator. And so, yeah.
Well, some people do use Illustrator with watercolor. I mean, it changes. It does really change the look of it. So that's what I've tried in when people like join my program, I've actually got like a video that explains the differences between both and shows what artwork will look like. Because that's what people don't know, and they don't know which one should I start with? What do I want to do? Yeah. So to really explain that, because I think you can definitely do both, and it depends on your style. I exclusively designed in Illustrator when I started. I think it was big when we started. It was like, and then
that look was big. You know, there was I feel like the vector really flat look was hot at that time, and
it was really hot.
Way more in the other direction.
Exactly.
I love Illustrator for the flexibility, but I'm working harder to add in texture. You know.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, and so they're both good for different things.
Yes. Totally.
Yeah.
Totally.
So, yeah.
Well, it's been an hour. It's gone by. There's obviously we have so much. So much of what you're saying. So I love to be in my own personal echo chamber of like, yes, mindset. Yes, this. I should try to find people who absolutely don't agree with me and then see how that goes, be a little bit more controversial. But. I love what you're teaching, and I'm really excited to have connected with you. And I know people are gonna love this talk because especially artists who aren't gonna have the opportunity to work in-house. I think hearing people who work in-house is so valuable, even if, you know, I mean, not like we're anything so special, but of course we are special. We're very confident and we're very wonderful, but no, someone told me like listening to these interviews is like listening to their like coworkers talking like by the water cooler or whatever, their older, like more experienced coworkers, not older, obviously younger, more beautiful, but like, you know, so I think that is such a valuable thing. And I know people are going to love hearing your side of the story. So
Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much. And obviously check out everything that Rachel is doing at Pattern and Design. Check the description for all her links. Thanks, everyone. If you love learning about surface pattern design and creative business, be sure to subscribe to this channel and follow me on Instagram at esilverdesign. Also, I would be super grateful if you shared this channel with your surface pattern friends.